can see, I got this beautiful pizza here, and I'm absolutely starving. This pizza is called the Carnivore, and I've never been to this pizza place before, so it's a first time for me, so I'm going to try it out. So, anyways, here goes. There. I forgot to order the thin crust. This might be a medium or a thicker one. So anyway, excuse me one second. So when I was a little kid, there used to be a TV show. It was made in the early 60s, only made for about two or three seasons, I think. It was called Rip Cord. And it was about skydiving. So anyway, the basic premise of this show was, it was two guys who they had their own airplane, like a Cessna, and they skydived, and they were they would assist the police in catching the bad guys, or rescuing somebody or something like that. So, and you have to keep in mind, back then skydiving was still kind of it was coming into its own as a sport. It was still kind of new as a sport. Fascinated me. And my friend Richard, when we were about maybe 8 or 9, we would put on these big puffy life jackets. Back in those days, they were really thick and bulky, right? And we'd pretend those were parachutes. And then his parents' car was always parked in the driveway. Obviously, and they had an old Morris Minor, a really old car, an old European car. And so we'd get in the back seat, and on the TV show, when one of the guys jumped out of the airplane, he'd always yell, "Cut," and that was to cut the engine back, and then he would just jump. And then he'd pull his ripcord at some point. So anyways, we would put these life jackets on, we'd get in the back seat. The door at the back of the car, and we pretend that we're the skydivers, and some guy was driving, right? And we'd yell "cut," and we'd tumble into the driveway with these life jackets on, pretending we were skydiving, and we'd be like this on our bellies in the driveway, this kind of thing. Not sure what the neighbors thought, but anyway, as time went on, I thought I'd like to try skydiving someday. So fast forward to 1981. This pizza's pretty good. The Carnivore. Very good. So anyway, 1981, I'm 24 years old. I'm just enrolled in cooking. Myself a girlfriend there, and who later becomes my wife, and 25 years later becomes my ex-wife. Anyway, this one day, I get up and I have my breakfast. I'm on my way. I used to live in this really nice apartment downtown, this high rise. So I'm on my way to school. I'm in the elevator, and my neighbor Bill comes in, and he says, "Hey, guess what?" And I said, "What?" He goes, was instantly jealous because I always wanted to do that. But I was happy for him at the same time. So I said, I always wanted to try that. Like, where do you go to do that? And he said, well, there was an Air Force base about 90 miles north of where we live. And he said they do skydiving during the summer almost every weekend. I said, well, it takes like I think about 3 hours of instruction or something. And I thought, great. So he gave me some contact information. And so I wrote a letter. This was a pre-email. And oh boy, that's good. I love bubbly. So anyway, I write a letter, let them know I'm interested. And you know, within a week, week and a half, I hear back from them. And you know, it's a military letter, very, you know, formal, neat and tidy. And they say, yeah, you know, if you want to skydive, come on up, you know. And now, I can't remember, but I think the price may have been $100 for the instruction and your first jump and so on and so forth. It wouldn't have been any more than that. Because if it was, I couldn't have afforded it. Back then, I was a starving student. I go up there, I sign up, and the course starts, and the only thing I had to bring with me was, they didn't have very many actual jumpsuits, so I said, if you got a pair of coveralls, bring them, and you'll need some good sturdy boots. So I had some coveralls, I borrowed some work boots off my dad or somebody. We start doing our training, and it's very basic. There's really not a lot to it. Now, there's basically two kinds of jumps. There's the tandem jump, where you're jumping and you're attached to somebody who's a qualified skydiver, or there's the static line jump. And I was going to do the static line jump because that's what they were teaching at that time, was the static line jump. And you know, you've seen footage of all these World War II parachuters. They're jumping out of a plane all the same time. They just jump, and within seconds their chute opens. That's because they have a line attached from their chute to the aircraft, so they don't need to pull the ripcord. It gets pulled for them the minute they exit the plane within. I mean, the static line is only 6 or 8 feet long, I think, so by the time you jump out of the plane, it's pulled your ripcord, and your chute deploys within, you know, maybe 4 or 5 seconds. So that's what I was doing. I was doing a static line jump. This course, you have to hang from these bars, and you have a chute on, and you practice different things. Like, for instance, you learn how to deal with a malfunction. Basically, there's two kinds of malfunctions: a total and a partial. A partial is when you pull your cord and your parachute deploys, but it starts streaming. You know, it starts streaming. Fluttering, it doesn't open. You don't have a full canopy, it doesn't open all the way. That's called a partial malfunction. So you need to get rid of that. So you pull down on these clips, it gets rid of the parachute, but then you have to open your emergency right away. Your reserve. Now that's a partial malfunction. A total malfunction is when your cord is pulled and nothing happens, nothing comes out. these chutes that we were using were older, were the round ones, quite old, not like those real nice square rectangular ones you got nowadays. I mean, they had those back then, but the Air Force had a lot of these chutes left over, probably from World War II, who knows, right? But they said they're actually more reliable, they malfunction less. The downside is you couldn't maneuver them as well. To maneuver a parachute, you got a couple of toggles. You know, you pull down this way and you start to turn and, you know, this kind of thing. So anyways, we went over all that. And then what we'd have to do is, there was a Cessna airplane on the ground. And we practiced. We'd get in the plane and you practice climbing out. And what you had to do was, you would have to, when it was your turn, you climb out. Foot on this little step off the airplane, cross over, put your left foot on the wheel, and then you cross over so your left foot's on the wheel and your right foot's dangling, and you're hanging onto the wing strut. So you're just hanging there under the wing strut with your left foot on the wheel. Now, some of these planes had a little platform built over the top of the wheel. This one did. So the pilot, what he would do is he would put the brake on so that when you went to put your foot on, it wouldn't roll off. That's fine. So anyways, I took the course that day. A few people went up and jumped. The next day I was hoping to go, but it was kind of breezy. And they wouldn't allow first time jumpers to go in. Winds over 5 miles an hour. So, okay, that's fine. I went home. Next week I came back. The weather was perfect. Now, when you do a tandem jump, you can go from 10,000 feet or whatever, a static line jump, you're only going from 3,500 feet. And by the time your chute opens, you're probably at about 3,000 feet. Now, the difference there is you get no free fall at all. I mean, you free fall for like 5 seconds tops, but you're on your own. Once you exit that plane, you're on your own. If you have a malfunction or something, yourself. As we're tandem jumping, you got that acceleration of free falling for, you know, like maybe a full minute, depending on how you are, right? So anyways, I go up there the second week, weather's perfect. So we're all taking turns, so plane goes up, takes some, you know, the thing about skydiving, there's a lot of waiting around. When you're in a group, you wait around, you wait around, you wait, all day, finally, it's my turn to go. And they've had a four-seater Cessna, but they've taken all the seats out except for the pilot. So there's the pilot, the jump master, who's in charge, and three students. So the pilot, he's all ready to go. He's in there. And the one student gets in, the other student gets in, then I get in. And it occurred to me very quickly that I was the last one in, which meant I was going to be the first one out. Definitely order this again. It's just a little shop up the street there. I just never been there before. I go down to the lights, turn right, and then make an immediate left. There's that pierogi place there. Subway. A beautiful Thai restaurant. I just noticed today they have a barber shop. But my girlfriend Linda, she cuts my hair for me, so don't need that. And there's also a dollar store. Pretty good one. Okay, so anyways, I get into the airplane. There's the pilot, the jump master, and three students, and we have to kneel down on the floor. So the plane takes off, gets up there to 3,500 feet. Jump master says, okay, we're going to turn around. When we come back, it's going to be your jump run, so get ready. So when I hear get ready, that means I have to climb out onto the wheel, holding onto the wing strut. And when he slaps my thigh, I let go. That's all I have to do. I climb out there. I'm looking straight ahead like I'm supposed to. Not looking down, looking straight ahead. I get out there, I'm hanging there, and all of a sudden I feel him slap my thigh. I let go. Gone. causes all this wind going on my pant legs and everything. And I always thought that when you jumped out of a plane, you just kind of float, you know what I mean? Well, you drop like a rock. I mean, why wouldn't you, right? And, so anyway, within about 5 seconds, I feel some huge jolt. And as I look up, my parachute is fully open, big round canopy, exactly what I wanted to see. There's no buildings around you to judge that you're actually moving. Like there's nothing relative, you know. So it felt like I was hanging there, like suspended in midair. And the view was amazing, you know, that little tiny airplanes on the ground. And I had no idea we were so close to the ocean. I just never thought about it, but all of a sudden I see all this water. I said, wow, you know. Fantastic view. See the mountains in the distance. As I was getting closer, there's two guys on the ground, this great big giant arrow. It's probably about 20 feet long. And they keep turning around, where, you know, if they want you to try and go this way, you go that way, try and go that way, you go that way. So it was kind of weird, because the first time I pulled down my toggle, what happens is your chute goes like that. But when you're up there, it's the earth that goes like that. It was really weird. You know, I didn't feel like I was turning. It was like the horizon was turning. It was like really weird. So anyways, I started coming down and I can see I'm getting closer and it's starting to come a bit faster. So what you're supposed to do is keep your knees slightly bent and your toes down a little bit. You're supposed to stare at the horizon. Just keep focusing on the horizon. So I did that. See how close I was getting. And all of a sudden I could see I was getting a lot closer. And just as I came down, I was getting really close, I pulled down on both my toggles and I came down and I just touched down. A little bit of a thud, but just really touched down. But then I lost my balance and fell over on my ass, right? But it was a very soft landing. My chute came down. And it was great. And suddenly I realized my dream. I jumped out of an airplane, didn't hurt myself, didn't kill myself. It was one of the best days of my life. This was something I always wanted to do, and I couldn't believe that I did it. You know, it's a little bit of an ego trip, but it was cool. I mean, you see these guys nowadays, they got those wingsuits and they're just zipping along through canyons. Oh, sorry about that. You know, and they're just doing all kinds of crazy stuff. Stuff that I wouldn't even dare to do. But all I wanted to do, I never wanted to pursue skydiving, I just wanted to try it. And I did. I'm so happy I did. You know, it's important to do the things that you're passionate about. That's a lot of pizza. That's a small